it's been about 2 years since I talked about Big Time Rush, the last being Big Time Christmas from December 2017. And considering the fact that we're in August, the month where summer is so hot and you do so many hot activities, I decided to do another review of Big Time Rush, which is another 1 hour special of Big Time Beach Party. And with this being an hour long, well, not really an hour long, but 46 minutes long, it's mainly about the Big Time Rush people and their friends going on the beach. You may think that's kind of a lazy cliche idea, but considering the fact that there's a character named JD who predicts the future and says that the beach, which is Malibu Beach, is a magical beach. You know, considering the fact that he completely said a magical beach, he probably predicted that Miley Cyrus just uploaded her music video, Malibu, in 2017. I would use that for the background music for this video, but I need to be respectful to Big Time Rush by having Boyfriend be the background music of this video. But anyways, Big Time Rush won a number one record, and they got permission to go to Griffin's Beach House, which is by Malibu. Kendall meets Sandy, and since this is a magical beach, Sandy has a huge crush on Kendall, which is going to be a big problem with Kendall because he doesn't have a crush on her. And the fact that this is a magical beach makes it really, really difficult for him to avoid her at all costs. And to make matters even worse, Taylor, who is completely in a different location because she's taking reshoots of one of the episodes, thinks that Kendall is cheating on her. And this happens like 3 times. Although at the end of the special, she completely forgives Kendall. And the fact that Sandy is actually an out of her mind psycho doing whatever she wants. I would question of how this works, but I'll get to any of that stuff later. After James failed to do the awesome waves on the beach, he encountered Annie, who he thinks that she's a mermaid because, well, he got some hints that her father was on the beach floor or the ocean floor, and the fact that she eats clams, which she actually does. You know, this is pretty much one of the only plots in the show where James actually has a really bizarre situation, while also very entertaining at the same time. Carlos and Logan are on a treasure, and they actually encounter Patchy the Pirate. And don't worry, this isn't going to be the only time we're going to see Patchy the Pirate in this month of reviews. Keep this in mind, I said month of summer reviews. Yeah, I'm not done with Patchy the Pirate because you're going to see him again in this month if you check my schedule of this month. But anyway, I would think that the scenes between Patchy, Logan, and Carlos just trying to find Trezor just really goes to show that this beach is really magical, and seeing Tom Kenny being part of this special while also being Patchy the Pirate, who he portrayed in SpongeBob, actually makes this a lot more sense since both Big Time Rush and SpongeBob are both in the same network. And since this is really much of a beach special to have all the characters be in one special for entertainment and actual screen time, they decided to have Mrs. Kendall's mom and Katie to go on the beach because Kendall's mom, they didn't put on the sunscreen. You know, I just don't understand why people are just halfway with sunscreen even though it's supposed to protect you. I just don't understand the joke behind avoiding sunscreen whatsoever. And as for Katie, she wants to be Russell's manager, who is one of the most famous people on this special. Yeah, I honestly think that the reason why they wanted to have Katie in this special is also to get an autograph from Russell. And I'm not a fan of Russell, I'm just thinking that this is probably something that they want to have Katie be part of, even though they want to have Russell be in this to make this special a lot more entertaining to have a guest star. As for the last subplot, Gustavo and Kelly wants to go to the beach and ruin big time Russia's party because they will stay on the beach forever. And the fact that the beach is pretty much one of the best activities big time Rush wants, because he completely shows Katie about a different boy band who got retired due to the fact that they refused to go back to the studio because they kept spending most of the time on the beach. You know, if Gustavo is aware of this and the fact that he's completely okay with Big Time Rush going on the beach, then wouldn't it make much more sense if in the beginning of this episode, well, he should make sure that all the stuff that Big Time Rush did was all a mix-up and a makeup in front of Griffin so that they won't be able to go to the beach house? I honestly think that this is probably Rush writing in the beginning of the episode, but it's just basically just trying to have Gustavo and Kelly do something at least. But I will admit that the humor in this special is hilarious. Holy crap, I've spent like the last several minutes talking about all the plots in this episode, and I only talked about minimum of my thoughts of the special itself. But at least I can talk about it now. With this being about a beach episode, well, mostly a beach special because this is 46 minutes long, you might understand what these guys are going to do on the beach, even though that it's not exactly a magical beach. But considering the fact that this is a Malibu beach and they want to make Malibu Beach a great place to be, they really want to throw in a treasure hunt, a mermaid subplot, and the fact that a beach babe is completely running after Kendall, who Willie doesn't have a crush on. And the fact that Katie wants an autograph with Gustavo and Kelly just trying to end a Big Time Rush party. You know, it's just, with those like 5 to 6 plots going on in this one special, I think it really goes to show onto why this is 46 minutes long instead of 22 minutes. I wouldn't say it's a bad thing, but I think that he probably had the ideals that, considering the fact that they're trying to make Big Time Rush more of an adventure, misadventures story, while the band are just going on through so much situations, kind of like in cartoons, but this is live action, they wanted to have this episode to be really special because they're on the beach and stuff. And while it is good to actually have some kind of attention on the beach, but having like 5 to 6 subplots going on at once, jeez. I really think that they probably want to do everything of what people do on the beach in cartoons, except that this is live action. But to be fair, the comedy actually works in, considering the fact of how these characters act and how this story plays out, well, except the Sandy Kindle plot, but I'll get to that soon. It really makes the special itself really entertaining, considering the fact that people are just having a fun time at the beach, and also the fact that they want to easily make every scene funny as possible. I mean, sure, the musical numbers might get a little obnoxious if you're not a fan of it, but this is the same musical numbers we've seen from Ned's Declassified show, which is a show that people actually enjoyed. I mean, sure, it is debatable when it comes to this since you're not a fan of Big Time Rush or not, but I kind of like this show mainly for the fact that this is just basically a way to profit the music Big Time Rush has. Same goes to Victorious when Victoria Justice is singing one of her songs in that show. Now, as I said moments ago, I said that the Kendall and Sandy plot is mostly the least of my favorite in this show, in this special. Not saying that it's bad, but considering the fact that this is basically a world where girls can do whatever they want without even gaining some kind of consequences, Sandy just immediately takes advantage of Kendall. And considering the fact that Kendall, one of the main characters of the show, and not being a selfish jerk, well, when it comes to his on responsibility actions, he really can't say no in a really quick situation. Even though when he tried to, my god. I honestly think that they probably wanted to make Kendall a bit miserable, but at the same time, really difficult to actually have some kind of advantages over goals in any situation. You know, if Taylor was actually spending most of her time on this beach, then maybe there will probably be some kind of fix up about this whole situation. But since there was an Oyo episode that we actually see Kinda with another girl in this scenario, then I think they don't want to reuse the same ideals as before. In the end of this plot, since that Kinda unintentionally, well, I say unintentionally because he didn't mean to hurt Sandy's feelings, Sandy calls out her real boyfriend. And considering the fact that JD said that this is a magical beach, he completely decides that they should fight each other in a drag race. Yeah. And since this is literally some of the activities that I actually didn't notice when it comes to beach activities, I'm definitely using some of these ideals in my fanfiction if I able to know how to know what an AT does, but I'm just saying. My point is that the ending of the subplot is just basically out of nowhere when it comes to beach activities, but this is literally something that we're supposed to expect from Kinda facing off a boy who only had 2 screen times before this race. I'm honestly not buying it. Not saying that this plot is terrible, but at the same time, the people who wrote this episode really needs to, you know, probably make the other characters at least tolerable. Seriously, this is really something that I just usually cannot stand when characters always take advantage with other characters, because the character who keeps taking advantage doesn't do anything as soon as possible. Show blindsiding is one thing, but considering the fact that it's just so hammered in, I don't think I'm ever going to be blindsided this way for the rest of my life. As for the other subplots, like James just trying to understand that Annie is a mermaid and Camille helping them, it's probably something that I actually found really humorous, considering the fact that even though that this is going to cost big time rushes 4 boys into 3 boys, I still think that this is literally a situation and scenario that James just hasn't experienced. I mean, it's really obvious that she wants to be with so many girls, but since that he met someone who is kind of a mermaid, and Camille just trying to show him what mermaids usually do under the sea, you know, the comedy with James just trying to fit as a merman really makes it probably something I actually enjoy from James as a whole. Sometimes James can be a bit stupid, but he's not just stupid. They actually trying to make him more funnier. The thing is, I don't usually like characters being dumb just because they're hot. That's something I just can't stand because it's a cliche that's getting done to death. And besides, the ending of this subplot is a misunderstanding where Annie is actually a competitive swimmer and her daddy owns a restaurant called The Ocean Floor. You know, I'm honestly starting to think that this subplot is just basically just to show what mermaids do, but we don't get to see actual mermaids in this. That will probably make this beach a lot more magical, and people will probably never leave no matter what. But I will say, this is probably my favorite subplot in the entire special. And as for Carlos and Logan, along with Patchy the Pirate, I would say this is what's going to be my best favorite in this special, but it's basically of how it's played out. It's really obvious that they're just trying to find the treasure, and while the comedy is almost as the same part as the James subplot, I will still think that the ending of this kind of makes this a waste of time. Mainly because they accidentally broke Griffin's antiques in the basement, and the fact that they could probably blow up half of his car. Yeah, that really goes to show that this subplot is just only forced, and they were about to go on another treasure hunt, but they're in a situation with Kendall loses, they're gonna leave the beach forever. But since that they won, they're on for another treasure hunt, except that there's not enough time to make this a double 44 minute special, if that actually makes sense. But I will say that I found this really entertaining, to say the least. I really don't want to talk about the other subplots like Gustavo and Katie in this, because like I said, they're just basically filler from all I know, and with this filling up like 5 to 6 subplots, I really don't want to talk about all of them. I'm just going to say that the Gustavo subplot is basically something that Gustavo feels and also just trying to be hilarious at the same time, while Katie being assistant to Russell, I'm really starting to think that this kind of plot involving Katie is just basically what little sisters usually do, but at the same time, it's getting way overused at this point. And the music sequence of Boyfriend and Beach, Beach, Beach at the end of this special, they're both really good. Even though the Beach, Beach, Beach is more of a cover than anything, Boyfriend is actually something that actually works in this situation, even though like Kendall doesn't want to be Sandy's boyfriend, obviously. But I will still think that the song itself and the vocals, despite me not being able to play the real song because of copyright issues and I have to do the instrumental, it's still a very entertaining song. Even though if you really like Big Time Rush or not, and the fact that they're completely done as a band since 2013 or 14, I guess this is probably something that we really, what we really need to expect from the band Big Time Rush of what they had, what they got as a music group. So to be quite honest, I really enjoy this special involving them on the beach, even though are some kind of forced and also making the beach more magical because it's Malibu and stuff like that. But on the other hand, you can easily ignore that because with Big Time Rush just trying to be really safe and also just trying to, you know, being its own thing, basically, I really respect it and understand what they're trying to go through for. If people say that this is one of the worst Nickelodeon shows ever, don't even bother. I just think that they probably wanted to make this their own thing. This isn't Dance Nile or any of those sitcoms Nickelodeon did in the past. Since this is trying to be its own thing, and the fact that Big Time Rush is mostly a tolerable band, while I like its music for my taste, I really think that this is basically what we really need to understand of what Big Time Rush is really all about. After reviewing Big Time Pranks, Big Time Christmas, and now Big Time Beach Party, if I'm ever going to be reviewing another Big Time Rush special or episode again, you need to understand what this world is all about. Just like Ned's Disclassified show. I can't remember the whole title, it's like 5 words long. I give this special a 7.5 out of 10. There's still gonna be more activities for this month, just stay tuned. Even though it kind of overstayed the beginning of this month because of the Hannah Montana Marathon.